Dubai's crown prince, who goes by the name Fazaa, is one of the richest royals in the world, with a personal net worth of $400 million. However, the Dubai royal family is worth much, much more than that, an estimated $18 billion. Growing up with that kind of wealth, it's no surprise the prince has some extravagant taste. He has everything from amphibious vehicles and his own fleet of luxury tanks to millions of dollars worth of exotic animals, including the most expensive horse and camel in the entire world. From yachts to exciting hobbies, here's how the Royal Prince of Dubai spends his millions. Let's start with where he lives. Of course, the prince, who goes by the title Sheikh Hamdan bin Mohammed, has plenty of options when it comes to luxury homes. The Dubai family owns plenty of expensive properties around the world, but these are the ones favorited by Fazaa. The first is the Royal Palace, because how could anybody not love living in this place? The Zabeel Palace is estimated to be worth as much as $500 million and officially belongs to the ruler of Dubai and Fazaa's father, Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum. These photos are from when the palace was lit up for an array of royal weddings. While the interior has been kept pretty private and visitors are allowed nowhere near the royal home, these shots of another of Dubai's royal palaces give us an idea of just how opulent it is on the inside. In fact, most of Dubai's royal palaces are in the same area, which is basically a large complex of several palaces where most royal family members live. To get away from life in Dubai, the prince has a favorite spot in Vancouver, Canada. He owns a $55 million penthouse at the Fairmont Pacific Rim Hotel. Nice, huh? Originally, Fazaa bought just one penthouse in the building for $25 million in 2017.
But why buy one when you can have three?
But then he quickly bought three sub-penthouse units just underneath it, bringing the total investment to $55 million, and reportedly, he paid in cash. Now the luxury penthouse covers 15,000 square feet over the building's top three floors. It features all glass walls for amazing views of the Canadian city's downtown, a loft seating area, a spacious kitchen, an office, and multiple living rooms and lounges. The prince also has ties to another luxurious hotel, but he doesn't just own a penthouse in this one. He owns the whole thing. Zabeel Investments is a private investment company owned by Fazaa that owns tons of properties across the United Arab Emirates, including the Hotel Jumeirah Zabeel Saray, located on the famous man-made luxury island of Palm Jumeirah. The Dubai hotel costs $12 billion to construct and has its own indoor and outdoor pools, access to private beaches for its guests, and tons of luxury suites. There are 405 rooms for guests, plus 38 royal residences where the Dubai royals, including Fazaa, can enjoy a taste of the Zabeel luxury meant just for them. Fazaa has been called a bit of an animal whisperer, a reputation he earned because of all the exotic pets he owns. His collection includes tigers, elephants, lions, and plenty of distinguished peacocks. But there's probably nothing more impressive than his camel, because it's the most expensive camel in the entire world. While searching for the world's greatest camel to add to his collection, you know, just like the rest of us do all the time, the prince picked this one out of 17,000 candidates. He bought the camel for $2.7 million, and it's been a star on his Instagram account ever since. Finally, an Instagram account worth following. While less expensive, Fazaa's falcons are also some of his favorite animals. The prince has individual falcons flown into the United Arab Emirates thanks to his falcon dealer, Bryn Close, who provides the prince with falcons exclusively. While we aren't sure exactly how much Fazaa spends per falcon, he's expected to own hundreds, and they can win the prince more than $100,000 anytime they win a race or competition. Does ESPN run falcon racing? Check that. Prince Fazaa even has another animal that's expected to be the most expensive of its kind. One of his prized show horses reportedly cost the prince $1.8 million, and he's been spotted showing it off at competitions all over the world. The prince is believed to own more than 1,000 horses across the world, and he has at least 120 camels on his farm in Dubai. While the prince could choose to get around on the backs of camels, horses, and elephants, he usually opts for his multi-million dollar car collection, which includes multiple gold vehicles. These flashy golden cars include a gold Rolls-Royce Phantom worth an estimated $8.2 million. He also has a golden Lamborghini Aventador worth $7.5 million, a Porsche 918 Spyder with a price tag of $5.8 million, and a gold Range Rover Vogue expected to be worth at least $3.2 million. He also has a Lamborghini Veneno Roadster worth $4.5 million. When the car was released in 2014, only 9 were ever produced, and he had the car gold-plated for an unspecified but probably extravagant amount of money. But the most expensive golden vehicle he owns is a Mercedes-AMG G63, worth an astonishing $9.6 million. His other non-golden, how dare he, luxury vehicles aren't really any less impressive. He has an Aston Martin 177 worth $1.9 million that was once thought to be the most expensive car in the world. It gets his name because there are only 77 of these cars in existence. His Bugatti Veyron Grand Sport is another unique addition to his collection. It's got a strange reptilian body, can reach speeds of 250 miles per hour, and it cost the prince $1.7 million. He also has a LaFerrari worth $2.1 million and a sleek Ferrari F12 Berlinetta worth $1.5 million. Okay, enough about the cars. What about his fleet of tanks? Prince Fazaa owns an extraordinary collection of luxury tanks. Is that a thing? Yeah, beloved by the rich. They can plow over any terrain, from sand and mud to snow, and they're also military grade and nearly indestructible. The prince has been spotted using them for joyrides in the deserts of Dubai. These ripsaw tanks cost $495,000 for a single seat model, $545,000 for two seats, and $595,000 for four seats, in case you were thinking of buying one. Since the prince seems to love to drive in any terrain possible, he's also got quite the collection of amphibious cars. The prince used to be a big fan of the python, but now he's upgraded to the next best thing, the panther. Though the python can reach a record-setting speed on water, about 60 miles per hour, it has an enormous $300,000 price tag. The newer pythons are even faster, but they're also cheaper and expected to cost $135,000. See, that's affordable. The prince spent $800,000 in total on multiple panthers to add to his collection to get a head start on the water vehicle trend before they officially hit the market. For a more relaxed time on the sea, Prince Fazaa also owns a few luxurious superyachts. One of them is the $70 million Esmeralda, but his most expensive yacht that he bought in 2013 cost $180 million, and it has everything he could possibly need on water, including a gym designed by Usain Bolt, several pools, and a personal spa, and a helicopter landing pad. And of course, the prince also has his own private plane. He uses the Boeing 747-400, which cost about $260 million. The Dubai Royal Air Wing has a fleet of them that can be used by members of the royal family. However, he also likes to fly first class on Emirates, which costs a minimum $600 per hour of flight time. Tickets across the globe can easily exceed $20,000 each. So there's one last question. How has the prince racked up such an impressive personal net worth? Does he really work for his money? Well, of course, there's Zabil Investments. The private investment company helps keep personal money in the prince's pockets, and the company has invested billions on buildings and construction projects. But obviously, most of the prince's net worth is thanks to his connections as a member of the royal family. While most of Fazaa's hobbies are just for fun, he's incredibly talented and takes part in a lot of competitions. He's an award-winning horse rider, semi-professional skydiver, and an accomplished athlete. He's also a talented poet and photographer, and is the founder of the Hamdan International Photography Award. With so many incredible hobbies and millions to spend on them, he doesn't seem to spend much time in the office. But if you were a royal, wouldn't you do the same?
Saudi billionaire Turki bin Abdullah has a $22 million car collection that will make your jaw drop. The uber-wealthy royal never misses an opportunity to show off his gold-plated supercars and luxury cruisers, and he even racked up some hefty parking fines when he was driving his whips around London. The globe-trotting prince is reportedly linked to the House of Saud, which at the time of writing was worth an estimated $1.4 trillion, so the parking fines didn't upset him too much. Here's a look at some of the fabulous gold supercars owned by Turki bin Abdullah. Prepare to be amazed. The most expensive gold car in Turki bin Abdullah's collection is his spectacular Bugatti Veyron. Bugatti Veyrons typically sell for $1.9 million, but when you wrap a Veyron in gold, expect the price to go way, way up. Bin Abdullah's gold-plated Veyron is worth an estimated $10 million, and it always turns heads when he takes it out for a spin. The Veyron might just be the most impressive supercar ever built. Bugatti developed the Veyron completely from scratch, and barely any parts or components from existing car concepts were used in its production. It's the pinnacle of supercar performance. The Veyron can reach a top speed of 408 kilometers per hour and is equipped with an 8.0-liter quad-turbocharged W16 engine. The powerful engine puts out more than 1,000 horsepower and can propel the Veyron from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in just 2.5 seconds. Not every car in bin Abdullah's collection is an ultra-fast supercar. If he wants to cruise around in something a little bit more classy, he opts for his gold-plated Rolls-Royce Phantom Coupe. The $4 million masterpiece has a top speed of 250 kilometers per hour and can go from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in 6.1 seconds. Sure, it's not particularly fast, but that's not the point of owning a Rolls-Royce. It's about cruising in style and showing off. Bin Abdullah's 18-karat gold-wrapped Rolls-Royce is just as nice inside as it is outside. The luxurious interior of the Rolls-Royce Phantom Coupe is decked out in the finest leathers, woods, metals, and fabrics. It really is the finest saloon car on the market. When Bin Abdullah wants to go off-roading, he hops in his Mercedes-Benz G63 AMG 6x6. His $2.5 million G63 6x6 looks right at home tearing through the sandy dunes of Saudi Arabia's deserts. Bin Abdullah even posted a video of himself racing alongside a camel in his G63 6x6. With a top speed of 161 kilometers per hour, the camel didn't stand a chance. The AMG was only on the market for 2 years, so even the ones that aren't gold are fairly rare. Bin Abdullah's massive fortune likely came from oil and gas, so it might seem a bit strange that he owns a Porsche 918 Spyder. The limited-production mid-engine plug-in hybrid comes equipped with a 6.8 kilowatt-hour lithium-ion battery pack that delivers an all-electric range of 19 kilometers. Bin Abdullah's 918 Spyder is not only gold, it's green too. The $1.5 million marvel is incredibly fast. It has a top speed of 340 kilometers per hour and can go from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in just 2.6 seconds. What supercar collection would be complete without a Lamborghini? Bin Abdullah's Lamborghini Aventador SV is not quite one of a kind, but it's close. It's one of only 500, so it's no surprise it's worth $1.2 million. The gold wrap really makes this supercar stand out, as do the car's iconic scissor doors. Bin Abdullah took his Lamborghini Aventador SV for a spin in an upscale part of London and was slapped with a $110 parking ticket. But he wasn't bothered and continued having his lunch. $110 for Bin Abdullah is like a penny to us regular folks, so it's no surprise he was unfazed. The fuzz also slapped a ticket on Bin Abdullah's G63 6x6 the same day. They must have been jumping for joy when they saw the gold cars parked on the street. Bin Abdullah's clearly a fan of Lambos because he owns a gold-plated Lamborghini Huracan. The $1 million beauty is equipped with a V10 engine and an electronically controlled all-wheel drive system that makes driving the supercar a breeze. Every Lamborghini is a work of art, so it's no wonder that Bin Abdullah is so fond of these spectacular supercars. The Bentley Flying Spur is one of the more affordable luxury cars on the market. The base price is just $187,000. However, Turki Bin Abdullah wanted to take his Flying Spur to the next level. What better way to do so than to wrap it in gold, of course? Bin Abdullah's $500,000 Bentley Flying Spur has a W12 engine that can generate 616 horsepower, so it's both powerful and flashy. A typical Range Rover Vogue is about as unassuming as you can get. However, the same can't be said for Turki Bin Abdullah's Range Rover Vogue. It's obviously wrapped in gold, but it also has a high-end Haman Motorsport tuning package. The $500,000 SUV has 322 horsepower instead of the standard 272, and is equipped with massage seats and a refrigerated storage compartment. The Range Rover Vogue can reach a top speed of 210 kilometers per hour and go from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in 8 seconds. Not bad at all for an SUV, although if he's in a rush, Bin Abdullah will have to take one of his Lambos. Not every car in Turki Bin Abdullah's car collection is gold. He also owns a modest Maybach 62 worth $450,000. He likely drives around in his Maybach 62 when he wants to go under the radar. While the Maybach 62 is a classy car, it's certainly not going to turn heads, especially if it only has a standard black paint job. There is a gold Maybach 62 out there in the wild, though, but it's not owned by Turki bin Abdullah. Dragon's Den star and entrepreneur Theo Paphaitis reportedly owns a $57 million Maybach 62. Yes, $57 million. Both the interior and exterior of Paphaitis' Maybach 62 are covered in gold. Talk about extravagant. Not everyone can afford a gold-plated supercar like Turki bin Abdullah, but it's actually possible to take a ride in one even if you're strapped for cash. London-based taxi service MyWhip actually offers passengers a chance to be chauffeured around in a gold-plated supercar. It's entirely up to chance, though. There's a 1 in 100 chance of being picked up in a gold supercar like a McLaren or Lamborghini. Looks like Turki bin Abdullah isn't the only one traveling in style. Here's an interesting fact. Did you know that Turki bin Abdullah has a pet cheetah? He even lets the big cat sit passenger side in his supercars. We wonder how he keeps the fast cat calm when he's cruising down the streets. Bin Abdullah is not the only wealthy Middle Eastern billionaire who owns a big cat. Lions, tigers, and cheetahs are extremely popular with uber-wealthy royals in the Persian Gulf.
Gold cars, $50 million dowry, $500 million divorces, and real gold C-3POs are just some of the ways Arab royalty flex their billions. Dubai's president, Abu Dhabi's emir, and supreme commander of the United Arab Emirates' army, Khalifa bin Zayed Al Nahyan, flashes cash in one of the world's flashiest cities. To stand out in the city with the world's tallest building, the Burj Khalifa, you have to do some spending. $15 billion is the bankroll as of the end of 2021, and here are some of the purchases. Cars, 200 of them. He has a bullet and bomb-proof $1.2 million Audi A8 LM and a purple $147,500 Mercedes-Benz A63. In terms of Lamborghinis, he has 7 Gallardos, 13 Huracans, and 21 Aventadors. There's a hefty McLaren section in Khalifa bin Zayed Al Nahyan's garage, 13 P1s, and 24 720s. He's got 7 LaFerraris. Whoa. Those go for 1.5 to 7 million apiece. A Koenigsegg Lycan Hypersport, many, many Mercedes and Paganis, as well as many other models of the aforementioned brands. The grand total estimated value of his total collection, 100 million. 120 million of the United Arab Emirates' second president goes to a private jet, the RS-860 Karori. It seats 5 in an uber-comfortable throne room-type setup in the cabin. And just on the other side of the partition is a California king bed for long naps filled with dreams in Technicolor. Is there more? Well, with these guys, there's always more. Sheikh Khalifa owns the world's largest yacht, the Azam. The 590-foot ultra-sleek vessel costs an estimated $605 million. The construction, operation, and maintenance of this massive private ship by Germany's Lürssen Yachts has created jobs for over 4,000 people. Its impressive size makes it almost comparable to a cruise ship. Sheikh Khalifa occasionally stays at Ascot Place in Windsor Great Park in Britain. He bought it in 1989 for $23.7 million from Mick Flick. You know, the Mercedes-Benz heir. Its 400 acres are surely worth quite a bit more than that now. And the lake, grotto, and estate cottages must be a pleasant change from the sandstorms as well as the hustle and bustle of Dubai. But apparently, the English water was not quite up to royal standards. So he had underground tanks installed and had them filled with the mineral water from the spa town of Evian-les-Bains in the French Alps. Not coincidentally, this is where a great many other Abu Dhabi royals live. Gotta keep up, right? His famous neighbor at Ascot Place, the Queen at Windsor Castle. Oh, you know, the lady on all that Canadian money. His ties to Britain don't end there, with $5 billion of his cash being tied to owning prime English real estate and has over 1,000 tenants. He owns more square feet of living space in London than the Duke of Westminster. You know, Prince George of Cambridge's godfather, that guy. Dubai's VP and Prime Minister Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum has pretty fat pockets himself. One of his biggest expenses, $500 million to his ex-wife Princess Haya of Jordan. Probably spent too much time out falcon hunting. Hope it was worth it. Sheikh Mohammed rolls around in a quarter mil white G63 AMG Mercedes No. 1, meaning it was the first one off the production line. but that's worth pennies compared to his golden car collection. He's got a $5.8 million gold Porsche 918 Spyder, a gold $7.5 million Lamborghini Aventador, a 9.6 mil gold Mercedes AMG 63 truck, a $3.2 million gold Land Rover Vogue, a 1.4 gold Godzilla Nissan GTR, which looks like it belongs on a serving tray, a $3.2 million gold Ferrari 360 Modena, an $8.2 million gold Rolls-Royce Phantom Drophead Coupe, and the crown jewel, a customized 24-carat Rolls-Royce that looks like it belongs in a Batman film, which costs a whopping $14.2 million. I wonder if racing purist Ettore Bugatti would be spinning in his grave if he saw Sheikh Mohammed's $9.2 million gold Bugatti Veyron. Personally, I prefer his $10 million candy cane red and white Veyron Pegaso edition. Like the Rolling Stones, Sheikh Mohammed loves horses. So much so, he founded the global racing team Goldolphin and its highly successful stallion operation, Darley. They have farms in Kentucky, England, Ireland, and Australia, and have over 100 racehorses worth well over $8 million, including horse racing Hall of Famer Hartnell. He celebrates his horse racing victories on his $400 million yacht named after his country, Dubai. The world's third largest private yacht at 531 feet has a lobster tank and a disco, perfect for a night of bisque and breakdancing. These Arab billionaires know how to party. But okay, enough about Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum's gold. Let's move on. The Emir of Qatar has more money than Queen Elizabeth, with a $2.1 billion fortune. Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani rules with absolute monarchy. And while some people treat themselves to Baskin and Robbins when they want to spoil themselves, Qatar's ruler treats himself to listening to Rick Ross's Maybach music in one of his dozen Benz S600 Maybach luxury sedans worth $516,000 apiece. He switches it up with his white $91,400 Lexus LX 570, three Bentley Bentaygas at $240,000 per unit, and for that show-stopping attention, a $500,000 Bentley Mulsanne limo. Okay, it's only a third of the price of Joe Biden's beast, but it's a lot prettier. When it comes to gift-giving, there's generous, and then there's this guy. He gives presents worth more than the Buffalo Sabres NHL franchise. He gave the Turkish president Recep Tayyip Erdogan a $400 million private jet, a Boeing 747-8. Inside it has a stateroom, a boardroom, and a hospital. It was to confirm Thani's special love for Erdogan. I wonder what the Turkish president got the emir in return. When Busta Rhymes rapped about A-Rap money, he was probably talking about people like Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani and his $500 million Al Usail yacht. Look, we like Busta Rhymes, but Busta Bus could barely afford to fill the tank with his $20 million net worth, as this 400-foot, 800-ton sea behemoth is the epitome of opulence. It's only the 33rd largest private vessel in the world. Earlier we saw numero uno, the Azam, but it may be the most luxurious with its European-styled furnishings, wood and leather trims, and extravagant staterooms. The Alawite dynasty king, Mohammed VI, is the current king of Morocco. One of the richest kings in the world, with an estimated net worth of $5 billion, His Majesty gets to live in the royal palace in Rabat. Its entrance is fit for a giant, and the king's personal mosque is an ideal place for moments of peace, as well as to take in top-shelf Moroccan architecture. Its classy mausoleum houses a marble casket that holds King Mohammed V, who died in 1961. Even the Pope was pretty impressed, and you've seen where that guy lives. Forbes reported that the palace costs $960,000 a day to operate, including personal expenses, clothing, and automotive repair costs. Yeah, Rolls-Royce and Mercedes S600 W100 repairs don't come cheap, let's be honest. Nicknamed the King of the Poor by his entourage thanks to his efforts to ease the burden of poverty of his people, King Mohammed VI flies to France in his private $600 million plus Boeing 747-400 to his getaway home just around the corner from the Eiffel Tower, which he bought for 94 mil. He bought it from the Saudi royal family, whom we'll get to in not very long. Real estate in France's capital goes for an average of $1,345.81 per square foot, so you know at 94 million it's a massive mansion. 12 bedrooms, a swimming pool, a games room, private garden, and private parking round out the purchase. With Paris parking spots costing around 40 grand, it'd be nice to have one in the heart of the City of Light. Although the monarchy was abolished in Egypt in 1953, Nassef Sawiris is an Egyptian billionaire wealthy enough to be pharaoh. With a current net worth of 8.1 billion, he is the second richest man in Africa after Aliko Dangote of Nigeria. With his cash, the Cairo kingpin bought himself a $70 million co-op in the world's priciest city in terms of real estate, New York City. The purchase of 965th Avenue for that price is the largest deal for a co-op in that city's history, topping David Geffen's $54 million Fifth Avenue purchase in 2012. Now that he lives right next to Macy's, he has 5 fireplaces for Santa to come down, 14 rooms for him to wander through to look for cookies, and a wraparound terrace so he can look down at Central Park and pretend he's watching a live-action version of Friends. Or Sex and the City, if that's his thing. The details on this family's Cairo property is a very tightly kept secret. He drives a relatively conservative $52,000 2019 Audi Q5, a little boring compared to the other cars we've seen in this video, but he makes up for it with his 240-foot Yala yacht, worth a hefty $80 million. And not just one, but 2 Gulfstream G650 private jets, worth a hefty $70 million apiece. That's more like it. Oh. How nice it would be to be able to sit on a couch while flying to New York City. Nothing like it, really. If you factor in all the wealth of all 15,000 members of Saudi's royal family, you're looking at $1.4 trillion. That crushes the British royal family's $28 billion. When most people talk in the trillions, they're talking about something to do with computer science or the wealth of entire first world nations, not a family. The oil juggernauts' bank accounts are mainly fueled by Saudi Aramco, and a lot of it is spent to keep you looking and keeping your eyes green with envy. Golden tissue boxes are just the tip of the iceberg. Let's start with Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. He ponied up $450.3 million for Salvator Mundi. That's an original painting by Leonardo da Vinci, by the way. At 3 different times, this painting has belonged to 3 different kings of England. It's nicknamed Jesus Christ, making it an oddly ironic purchase for someone of Muslim descent. Also known as MBS, Mohammed bin Salman paid $300 million for the world's most expensive home, France's Chateau Louis XIV. Royals seem to like to follow the footsteps of royals. In the same way Hollywood kingpin David Geffen set his sights and succeeded in living in movie mogul Jack L. Warner's Beverly Hills mansion, MBS succeeded in living in Louis the Great's castle. It's got a labyrinth like the house in The Shining, a farm, and a veggie garden. It's got a great many statues of a great many French nationals, and a real gold statue of Star Wars' C-3PO? Okay. And the gold doesn't stop there. It's all over the house and adorns the massive fountain at the front gate. The number of bedrooms, 10. The amenities, like the pool and indoor cinema with reclining red leather seats, might I add. The wine cellar, all not too bad. But the icing on the cake. It's the moat that surrounds the property that gives it that timeless look of we got money over here, along with a transparent underwater chamber to boot. You can slip downstairs to marvel at the fish on leather couches as you ponder your next major move. What's next for MBS and the Saudi royal family? Will they wish to buy the moon like George Bailey did in It's a Wonderful Life? If it was for sale, they'd buy it. But when you're that rich, you buy things that aren't for sale. MBS has been trying to buy Manchester United for quite some time, and may be on the market to buy Newcastle United from the Premier League. They play, you know that video game, Club Manager? But in real life. What else when the world is not enough? Weddings are another way to burn up Saudi Arabian rials. 2017's royal wedding of 62-year-old Saudi Prince Sultan bin Salman to a 25-year-old bride with a never-ending dress was quite expensive. The convoy was 50 white Range Rovers long, white being the color of the king. The dowry to the bride and her family was a rumored $50 million, and the money apparently arrived in 30 or so suitcases off a bus that probably should have been a Brinks truck. Other gifts came off a chariot fit for Cinderella. The lavish ceremony took place at the Four Seasons Hotel in Kuwait at Burj Al Shaya. The gifts were diamonds, and more diamonds. Bin Salman bought himself a serene yacht from Russian vodka industrialist Yuri Scheffler for $502 million. The 432-footer costs $49 million to run every year, which is $136,000 a day, or $5,650 per hour. It comes with a helipad and a chopper on the bow. Cause hey, when you're a Saud and you gotta go, you gotta go. Most upper echelon millionaires and billionaires fly in small to mid-sized private jets. The Saud family kicks it up a notch. Prince Al-Wahid flies high in a luxury 747. Fueling it up ain't no problem when you've got a quarter of the Earth's known oil supply. The master bedroom, yeah, there's a master bedroom on the plane, has a shower that's, well, made of gold. And the king bed has white linens and at least 10 pillows. The $18.7 billion man also bought Donald Trump's 282-foot yacht in 91, the Trump Princess, for $20 million at the time, back when the real estate mogul needed quick cash. He renamed it the Kingdom 5KR. Gotta put your name on it, you know. That ship has been around, having been seen in the James Bond film Never Say Never Again, where she was called Flying Saucer. Hey, if Sean Connery's been on your yacht, she's priceless. She also served as a muse for Queen for their 1989 song, Khashoggi's Ship. Nice way to be immortalized. The high seas isn't Prince Al-Wahid bin Talal al-Saud's only flex zone. He is a highway superstar when driving his $48 million diamond-encrusted Benz SL600. Yes, even the tailpipe is bling bling. There are some Swarovski crystal accents to fill in some of the gaps here. He did the exact same thing for his $20,000 Ducati motorcycle for $4.8 million as well. Cause hey, you only live once, right?
If you're a royal, you gotta have a palace to back up your title, right? Well, Arab royals don't hold back. A Saudi crown prince has now bought the most expensive home in the world. It's time for your royal tour of how Arab billionaires spend their money and the luxurious abodes where they lay their heads at night. And you know that pillowcase is bespoke Egyptian cotton. Let's begin with Prince Al-Walid bin Talal, a member of the Saudi royal family, as he is the nephew of the late King Abdullah. His net worth is estimated at $19 billion, making him one of the richest people in the world. He's definitely the richest person in Saudi Arabia and one of the wealthiest in the Middle East, so you know his mansion must be incredible. Or should I say palaces, plural. Three palaces belong to Al-Walid, two are already in existence, and a third is in construction. In central Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, he lives in a 250,000 square foot palace known as the Kingdom Palace, featuring 317 rooms furnished with Italian marble, silk oriental carpets, gold-plated faucets, and 250 televisions. The place is valued at $130 million. The palace has personal chefs who boast they can feed 2,000 people within a given hour of notice and work in four different kitchens. One for Arab cuisine, one for continental, one for Asian cuisine, and a fifth for desserts. Guests can relax in the lagoon-shaped pool and watch a movie in the 45-seat cinema that's located in the basement. Of course, the road leading to the palace is named after the man himself, Prince Talal Road. The compound features three outdoor pools and a large indoor swimming pool. There are several different buildings on the estate, including a mosque. The other palace I had mentioned before is a 500,000 square foot kingdom resort. It features three lakes and gardens and is where he typically entertains his guests. It's kind of like his own personal hotel, at least he uses it like one. At this palace, the prince entertains his most important guests, such as his old pal, Khaldun al-Mubarak, Bill Gates, parliamentary delegates from around the world, and other VIPs. Kingdom Oasis is still under construction, and it's going to be a 4 million square foot palace. It plans to be a luxury resort that will include a private zoo and a 70,000 square meter lake. Oh, did I mention he bought a castle too? Yep, the castle of Castagneto. On the hills of Turin, Italy, the prince bought this house in 2009. And every time he visits Southern Europe, he stays in this artistic house that is situated in a cozy neighborhood in Turin. A house of this size occupies 21,528 square feet of land, which is the equivalent of 173 acres. There are several orchards, vegetable gardens, flower balconies, as well as a vintage greenhouse on the vast property. Al-Waleed owns a floating palace as well in the form of an 85.9 meter yacht called Kingdom 5KR, the 65th largest private yacht in the world, which was originally built for the Saudi arms dealer Adnan Khashoggi in 1979. It was even in a Bond movie. In Never Say Never Again, it appears as a yacht owned by James Bond's villain, Largo. Donald Trump also owned it once too, but he ran into some well-publicized financial problems in the late 1980s and sold it to the Prince. It has a disco, cinema, helipad, pool, guest rooms, and all the other luxuries one can imagine. From the seas to the sky, he also owns several aircraft converted for private use: a Boeing 747, an Airbus 380, and a Hawker Siddeley 125. The Boeing 747 is equipped with a throne, two bedrooms, and a dining table with 14 seats. Apparently, each crew member and flight attendant is from a different country. He likes his variety, I suppose. The Airbus comes complete with a Turkish bath, a concert hall, an executive boardroom with holograms, and a garage for his Rolls-Royce. So where does the money come from? Well, he's royalty, but some of his assets include a 95% stake in Kingdom Holding Company, 91% ownership of Rotana Video and Audiovisual Company, 90% ownership of the Lebanese Broadcasting Corporation, about 6% ownership of Citigroup. Oh, and in 2011, he acquired a $300 million stake in Twitter. Okay, remember I mentioned an Arab prince that bought the world's most expensive home? Well, that prince is Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman, and the home is the Chateau Louis XIV. It was purchased for over $300 million. It is based on 17th century French castles, but it was built near Versailles between 2008 and 2011. Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman is heir to the Saudi throne. If you're lucky enough to get invited, you won't want to miss gawking at the marble statues, a hedged labyrinth set in 57 acres of landscape park, and a gold leaf fountain. Gold is a common theme throughout the lavish palace. The fountains, sound system, lights, and air conditioning are all controlled by his iPhone. The meditation room, or chilling room, of Chateau Louis XIV is one of its most remarkable features. The aquarium features a see-through underwater chamber where sturgeons and koi swim. The 57-acre grounds are also home to a statue of Louis XIV made of costly Carrara marble. The property boasts 10 suites, a 52-foot-high painted dome ceiling in the reception room, a library, and a 3,000-bottle wine cellar, enough to toast his football team, Newcastle. This hotel has an indoor pool and an outdoor pool, a private cinema, a squash court, two ballrooms, and a nightclub. The prince isn't one to brag either. When bin Salman bought the Chateau Louis XIV, he wanted no one to know about it, using shell companies in France and Luxembourg. He tried to conceal the purchase. He might want to be incognito, but he definitely isn't afraid to spend. His other extravagant purchases include a $500 million 440-foot superyacht and a $450 million Leonardo da Vinci painting. Off now to the Scottish Highlands to check out Invernate Lodge, owned by Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum, ruler of Dubai, prime minister, and a vice president of the United Arab Emirates. He bought this estate more than 30 years ago. The 71-year-old Sheikh, who has had six wives and up to 30 children, and an estimated worth of $18 billion. The estate has a 14-bed manor house and a 16-bed guest house. This luxurious hunting lodge has a swimming pool and gym as well. The mansion by the water has a long history. An 1864 fire destroyed the original Invernate House, which was rebuilt in 1929. Prince has added a few additions to the Highland home. The massive lodge is undergoing improvements to this day, as the Sheikh plans to build four helipads behind the walled garden so he can transport his guests to the remote Highland estate easily. A swimming pool, gym, and leisure facilities are also included in this new modern hunting lodge, located near one of Scotland's most famous landmarks, Eileen Donning Castle, and it sits on a 63-acre estate. Every summer, he and his family visit the estate, but locals say he's rarely there. Must be nice. Let's pop over to London now, shall we, and check out the chic shack of Hamad bin Abdullah Al Thani. Okay, not quite a shack. This is the Qatari sheikh who decided to restore this 44,000 square foot townhouse in London, England. Over the decades, many historic London mansions of the British elite have been torn down for newer developments. But because of Hamad, the Dudley House stands today. This is one of the few surviving aristocratic townhouses in London at 100 Park Lane. This is one of Britain's most expensive private residences. The art and antiques in the house are worth millions on their own, but the home has an estimated value of $400 million. As a member of Qatar's royal family, His Highness Sheikh Hamad leads a quiet life compared to other Arab royals, but restoring this home to its former glory was a labor of love. After a six-year renovation, the 44,000 square foot, 17 bedroom residence, which has an 81 foot picture gallery and a 50 foot ballroom. This home has always been a popular venue for London's elite, including Queen Elizabeth II, who said, "This place makes Buckingham Palace look rather dull." She may be right. From London to the Tangiers compound in Tangier, Morocco, where King Solomon of Saudi Arabia loves to hang out. Known as the Saudi ruler's favorite hideaway, the expansive complex is surrounded by 1,500 meters of walls, has its own medical facilities, and is equipped with a state-of-the-art restaurant kitchen. This massive oceanfront compound in Tangier is heavily guarded and manned by more than 30 Moroccan royal guards. It has two helipads, multiple buildings, and a massive tent that was added to the retreat over the last year. Back to London we go to visit Sheikh Amoza, as he bought three adjacent homes in London for £191 million in 2014. Three properties of the Qatar royal family have been combined into one mega mansion, 1, 2, and 3 Cornwall Terrace. Qatar's royal family now owns more property in London than the royal family of England due to the addition of this mega mansion. With an approximate value of £313 million, this is one of London's most expensive homes. This enormous mansion was designed by Decimus Burton, the protege of John Nash, architect of Buckingham Palace. The 33,000 square foot mansion has 13 bedrooms, a spa, heated swimming pool, beauty salon, personal butlers and nanny quarters, a children's floor, games room, powder rooms, massage areas, two elevators, and a gymnasium. Kitchen seats are heated in the winter, and in the summer, dramatic lighting creates the illusion of a ballroom in the gardens. A cigar room and wine cave are available for all guests, as well as a huge amount of bedrooms to choose from. An iPad controls the lights, while staff members live in separate quarters in the building. This place is massive, but hey, he has three wives who have produced more than 20 children, so a big house is in order. He has a fortune of £1.5 billion, so he can afford it. In addition to the heated swimming pool and gym on the lower ground floor, which will be separated by a glass wall in order to create an illusion of space and light, a fireplace made from champagne gold metal and Carrara marble are among the luxurious fittings in the mansion. Bathrooms apparently receive a minimum of 3 air changes per hour, and each room's temperature can be customized. Apparently, for the family, 23 degrees Celsius is the ideal temperature in the living areas, 22 degrees Celsius in the bedrooms, and 25 to 30 degrees Celsius in the pool areas. I keep my home's temp at 18 Celsius all the times. Sure, my girlfriend freezes to death, but do you know the price of energy these days? One place where AC is a must is LA. And one of the most exclusive LA gated communities is Beverly Park. It's home to Prince Turki bin Nizar. But he's trying to sell it for $39.95 million. Around 70 estates surround the prince's compound in the mountains above Beverly Hills. These properties range from 8,000 square feet to 30,000 square feet. And you can guess Prince Turki has the biggest property in the most exclusive neighborhood. They share their neighborhood with Denzel Washington, Eddie Murphy, and Mark Wahlberg, all of whom own properties in the area. Across both properties, there are 49 bathrooms, 14 bedrooms, and 22 bathrooms in the main house. The interior is all marble, gold, and parquet. There is a 4,000 square foot living area in the master suite, and the dining room can seat 35 people. The living room has a fireplace and French doors that lead to the terrace. Views of Beverly Hills and the swimming pool are available from the balconies. There are also smaller guest houses and staff quarters nearby, measuring 3,000 square feet and 14,000 square feet, respectively. There are 8 bedrooms and 17 baths in both these properties. This Beverly Hills compound is worth $145 million and is owned by a business entity affiliated with the late Saudi prince Saud Al-Faisal. Set on roughly 14 acres, the grounds include more than 35,000 square feet of interior space, which might be combined from multiple structures. Outside, there are 3 tree-lined promenades, a pool, and a tennis court. There's an entryway with a retractable roof and a courtyard. In addition to its interior spaces, the Beverly Hills Estate, there are additional guest and staff residences, as well as a dramatic courtyard entrance with a water feature. It has a spectacular private driveway, and up from there, you can see the ocean all the way to Catalina Island. Let's end things in Iran, shall we? In Tehran, a palatial estate nestled against the Alborz Mountains, a place no Iranian would ever dream of visiting at the time, but not anymore. The entrance fee today is a mere dollar. On a 27-acre plot, the Nayavaran Palace is a complex of mansions in which one can marvel at the luxuries the Shah enjoyed during his reign as Iran's monarch for nearly 4 decades. The compound dates back to Iran's Qajar dynasty in the 1800s, when the monarchy chose to build a summer palace on the mountainside. As Tehran grew during its oil boom of the 1960s, the Shah's third wife, Queen Farah, had been an architecture student. She spent millions of dollars renovating the compound's palaces. One of the wings of the palace became a private art gallery of pieces she purchased around the world. The Royal Library Museum is also another sight to see. The interior design with the modern architecture of the time is unique. They use this place not only as a library, entertain guests, and display artwork such as paintings, furniture, and sculptures. Finally, you're going to want to check out the green space of the complex. You can visit the Inscription Garden Museum. Also, Darband and Darakeh are great natural attractions near the complex. If you're planning to visit Iran in the winter, you can also do some skiing and other winter activities. The Shah was known to walk around the grounds or speed along the roads in one of his many sports cars. A pilot as well, he'd fly helicopters in and out, staying off the streets as tensions rose. All the spending and long circulating rumors of embezzlement surrounding the Pahlavi dynasty helped fuel anger against the monarchy. In 1979, the pressure became unbearable for the Shah, and he fled the palace for the last time by helicopter. So now the complex is open to visitors today, so they can walk the halls of the Shah's former residence and even see the clothes and items he left behind. The dress uniform of the Shah, complete with a ceremonial sword sheath, stands on a headless mannequin in one room. The Shah and his queen are also depicted in 2 paintings. Among the cars, housed in another building in the complex, are 3 Rolls Royces, 5 Mercedes-Benz, 6 motorcycles, and even a snowmobile. Prince Ali Reza's study room was also left behind, complete with an electric piano, stuffed kangaroos, a picture of naval warships taped to the walls. And this is one Iranian royal home that you can feel free to visit today, and it feels like a time capsule of another era. According to Forbes this year, there are 22 Arab billionaires worldwide. This is good news to the richest because these homes are definitely worthy of our attention. Hopefully more mega mansions will be on the way so we can show you more and more. It's kind of our thing.